So let me ask you about this share buyback then that you've announced, or increasing the pace of the share buyback. Why have you decided to do that with your cash rather than to buy more capacity, to add capacity to your network?
Well, I think over the last few years, our earnings have gone up quite a lot. This is the 11th quarter in a row with year-on-year progress. Cash has followed, and we are basically, we don't have very much debt left. So we have plenty of capacity both to build our business, but certainly also to share excess cash with our shareholders at this time.
Good morning, Soren. Look, obviously last month a shipping meme dominated the internet. It's probably one of those rare times where we all cared about what was happening in the shipping container world, everyone out there. But we all thought it got resolved. Why is it that we expect the Suez Canal blockage is going to linger on the container prices and going to affect the market into the third quarter this year? Can you explain that to viewers?
Well, I do think that, first of all, this is one of the situations where a picture is worth more than 1,000 words, for sure. But reality is that demand has been strong also before the Suez Canal blockage, driven by, the world opening up again, people spending on goods more than services. And it is that underlying strong demand that is keeping freight rate levels at relatively high levels, more than it's the Suez Canal blockage. That certainly added to the party, if you will, but it is a trend that has been going on for quite a while.
And Soren, has the Suez fiasco, did that teach the industry anything? Has it led to any conversations within the industry about how things need to change, about bottlenecks, about larger and larger vessels, and whether all waterways are fit to take them? What kind of conversations are happening in the aftermath of the Suez incident?
Well, this is the first time we've seen an incident of this nature. It's not the first time that ships have grounded in the Suez Canal. That happens from time to time, but it's the first time that we've seen an incident where the ship was stuck for any length of time. And obviously, as an industry, we need to learn from that and figure out what went wrong. And lots of investigations are ongoing right now, so that we make sure that we take the precautionary measures that we need to take to avoid this situation happening again in the future.
Next time, perhaps we need more than one digger to get it out. But moving on from that, have you been able to take advantage of the very high spot rates in freight to secure very favourable long-term contracts? And can you give us some kind of guidance to quantify that? Like, what percentage of longer-term contracts have you secured this year relative to the same time last year?
We have used this market this year and last year actually to continue to build our portfolio of long-term contracts with our large customers, and we have indeed increased significantly our ratio of long-term contracts with those customers that have a partnership approach with us. So that is definitely going on. I think our long-term contract portfolio is up from around 45% to around 55% of our book of business now.
Okay, so from 45 to 55, that's interesting context. Sticking with the subject of freight rates, Soren, last time I spoke to you, you talked about how you expected to see some normalization of those freight rates during 2021. From what you've seen so far this year, can you be any firmer around the timescale? Any sense that this period of elevated freight rates will come to an end, and over what time horizon?
Well, we have upgraded our guidance at the EBITDA level to 13 to 15 billion dollars. We did 4 billion in the first quarter of EBITDA, so obviously we're expecting the market to stay relatively strong for quite a while. That is, of course, backed up by a significant increase in our long-term contract portfolio. We're adding about or more than $3 billion to earnings this year from our contract portfolio. So we have a strong expectation to 2021. We are also seeing quite a lot of growth in our other businesses, both our ports business, but certainly our logistics business, which is now, have a run rate of more than $8 billion of revenue. And we expect to continue to grow that part of the business as well in this year and the coming years.
Away from the benefits of higher freight rates, how are you using technology to improve margins at the moment?
We use technology in different ways. First of all, of course, we are digitizing the transactions with our customers and using Maersk.com as our main vehicle for transacting with our customers. That means our customers are self-serving. It provides them with a better customer experience, but it certainly also helps us take cost out when the customer is doing, if you will, the work him or herself. But we're also using technology to optimize how we run the business, both all of our machines, if you will, the ships, the ports, the containers, and we are using technology to standardize and optimize our internal processes. So it comes in different ways.
I'll go to another question, Soren, kind of where I started the conversation. You've announced the increased pace of share buybacks this morning, and there, I assume, are other things you could do with the money, although you've explained why you've decided to give it to shareholders. I noticed that there are others in the industry, I'm told by colleagues, there are others in the industry that are buying equipment, that are buying vessels at this point. The number three container, CMA, CGM buying equipment. They've ordered 22 new ships. Are you ordering new ships? If not, why not at this point where we see freight rates so elevated?
Well, we are focused on supporting our customers and want to make sure we have capacity to do that. But we also focused on building the other parts of our business, namely the landside logistics business. We've done three acquisitions in that space, and I think we should expect to do more as we build up our logistics business and provide integrated logistics to our customers. The pandemic is, if anything, has shown the importance actually of being able to provide integrated logistics to our customers. And the very strong growth that we are seeing in our logistics business is a validation of our strategy. And that's really where we want to focus. We still, of course, we have more than 4 million TEU of capacity, and we want to remain around that level in the coming years. We need to buy ships to replace ships that are getting old and so on. But we're not looking to grow market share or anything like that on the ocean side.